Let's try it twice through and then instrumental. So if you could go on the loop before we bow down, and then we'll come in and say, "You are all I need." And then finish on the bow down. Do you think it's too long? Have you been able to do that before? Thank you. Does that mean we need to deliver Susanna?
It's your face. I
that direction, he was like.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome back. Nice to see no one's brought a glass of wine into this meeting. I was quite worried about that, if that was the case. One notice for later, or two notices really. One, there's no fire alarms or anything like that scheduled for this weekend. There's no alerts planned. So if an alarm goes off, we really are on fire. Okay? And so you'll see there's notices around about fire escapes, all that kind of thing, but generally we meet at the assembly point, it's in the car park outside of the main reception area, and just there, that's the assembly point. Okay. And just this afternoon, from, when is it, 1:30 to 4:30, it's free time, so it's a lovely day. Some of you, I know, are planning to go for a walk. If you're going for a walk, David is organising that, and you're going to meet at 2:00, in the reception area or just outside the reception area. He will gather you up and shepherd you on the walk. I'm sure there'll be some boys who want to play football. If there's any dads who want to organise a football tournament, I'd be very grateful. Okay? So, if you feel that calling, follow it. And I think that is all my notices. And let's stand. So Lord, we thank you for bringing us together, and we offer you this day and particularly this session. And Lord, we come to learn from you, to be challenged by you, to be encouraged by you. We pray for John that you would minister to him as he ministers to us, and that you'd speak to us to the glory of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Christine is going to lead us.
We're going to start by singing together, in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit. Here we come. Here we come. Yeah. Yes, that's right. Here we go.
Thank you.
Doesn't have just to be somebody at the front with a microphone who prays. It'd be great if just one or two people in different parts of the room would just say a short prayer of praise and thanksgiving, and then we'll close this time of worship together.
Lord, we just thank you for the privilege of being able to be together. We thank you that we can have the opportunity to truly worship you. And Lord, we just ask you to show us your heart today. Show us your move of your spirit in this place. Amen. Amen.
Lord, we pray that your spirit will move in each one of us. Father God, thank you for your spirit, thank you for your son, thank you for your love, thank you for this glorious day, thank you for the amazing body of Christ that is St. John's. Amen. Amen.
Ma'am, please take a seat. Just been down the nursery, it's all working fine, so you've got little ones with you and they get a bit distracted. You can take them down there, it's all been streamed through there. Hello, people in the nursery. they can see us and hear us. We're going to invite John to come up and speak to us.
I think somebody's going to get a mic for me. I think that's going to happen, so I can be a little bit more mobile and just be behind here. That's my first challenge that I've failed. There we go. Okay, are we on? Fantastic, great. Have we got the next thing, slides on the screen yet? Tim's working on that. Just want to say, it's got a great feel. I have the privilege of doing a number of these different weekends. And you just feel really good together as a church. It's such a lovely sense of warmth and joy and being together, and also a real sense of faith and people talking to me about faith and life. So I'm really encouraged just to be with you already. I'm strengthened by just the conversations I've had already. Fantastic. Thank you, Tim. What we're going to do over the next three sessions is we're going to look at John 14 to 16, we're mainly going to focus in on John 15 and the image of the vine and the branches. And with this idea of challenged and empowered, I want us to think about the life that we're called to live in relationship with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And the reason I've chosen these chapters is that they are unique in the Gospels. When you read the Gospels, most of the time what you're having to do is you're having to translate the experience of the disciples in physically following Jesus into our experience today. And when I do that, sometimes I get a little bit jealous because I think it was much easier for you guys. I know it was sacrificial and it was radical and all of that, but you just left everything and you followed Jesus. And you know, we know that Peter had a mother-in-law, so presumably he had a wife, but he still left and he followed Jesus and he left their business. And I go, well, I've got a family to manage, and I've got a house to look after, and I've got all of this to do. What does it mean for you to me to follow you, Jesus? In these three chapters, Jesus is speaking and preparing his disciples for the fact he's not going to be around for very much longer. And he says, this is how to live in relationship with me when I'm gone. So this in the Gospels is the unique set of chapters that really reflects our experience today. And that is in knowing God through his Spirit and following him and being in relationship by the Holy Spirit. And so that's what we're going to look at over the next three sessions. So if we'd like to turn in our Bibles to John 15. I have a little obsession with the importance of reading God's word. And in Holy Trinity Leicester, we have in Lent instructed everybody to bring a physical Bible to church every Sunday. Not that it's not good on your electronic device, so if you turned on your electronic device, that's absolutely fine. If you play Candy Crush or look at your emails, you'll go to hell, but that's just the way it is. But I really do like people to have physical Bibles and for us to begin to relate to the book and to know where passages are and get a sense of God's word. So in each of the sessions, we're going to read these first 17 verses of John chapter 15. One of my college lecturers always said, always read the word of God, because if you're rubbish, at least they've heard the word of God, John. So that's what we're going to do. John 15, verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burnt. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that your joy may be complete, my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Apologies for my voice. I think it's going to last, but it does sound as if I'm going through puberty at the moment. It's going up and down a bit, so we'll see how that goes. So here we have this beautiful picture of the vine and the branches. We have Jesus as the vine and us as the branches. And as he paints this picture, he is describing a relationship between us and him that is so intimate. It's not mechanical, it's not bolted on. There is a sense of life flowing from one to the other. And there's no point if you look at a vine in which you can say, oh, that's the join, that's the bit which is the vine, that's the branch. You know the extremities, but in that point of connection, they are one. And Jesus is describing the relationship we're to have with him, of intimacy, of dependency, of being one with him. He's giving a picture to the description that we are one, that we are in Christ, as Paul describes it, that he is in us and we are in him, that you can't separate us, that there's no sense of where one begins and the other ends. And it's a life-giving image. It's one that is organic, of something that is growing and alive. It's not something that's mechanistic and regulated, but it's something that comes out of health and life. And he communicates something of the life we're to have in the Holy Spirit. It's a picture of the Trinity as well, with the Father as the gardener, Jesus as the vine, and by implication, the flow of the Spirit as the life-giving flow from the roots all the way through the vine into the branches. And so we have this really challenging image. It's a beautiful image. It's a lovely image. And we can look at plants and creation and say, isn't that amazing that God has given us? But I also think it's a challenging image. A challenging image because it's to describe you and me and our relationship with Jesus. And scripture is meant to be like a mirror that we hold up in front of ourselves and go, oh, that's where the difference is. That's where I see some work to do. That's where I see something that I need to address. And one of the phrases in there, there's just an illustration for me, is it says, ask whatever you want in my name and it'll be given to you. Do you ever have those experiences where you read a verse and you go, I know this is the word of God, but I don't like it, or I don't agree with it, or I don't understand it? Well, that's one of those verses for me. So it's, ask anything and it'll be given to you. Now, I think the challenge for me is that the previous verse says, if you remain in me and I in you, ask anything. And so I often complain, why isn't that my experience? And then I hold scripture up to my life and I go, that's why it's not my experience. Because the previous verse is not my experience. I expect God to keep his side of the bargain. He meant to give me everything I asked for, Father. But actually, I haven't done the work that he's asked me to do, which is to remain in him. So I want us to think about the love that God has for us that is shown in this passage. So I think that changed on here, but it didn't seem. There we go, fantastic. When we read this word abide or remain, it's a Greek word which is meno, and it literally means to stay in a place, to live in a place, to make your home in it, to actually find your place of belonging and to live in that place. And as we hear Jesus say, meno in me, what he's saying is he's saying, remain completely in me, live in me, find your home completely in me, find your place to stay in me. Translations of that verse, if you make your home in me and I make my home in you. When you're joined with me and I with you in an intimate, organic relationship, then you'll bear much fruit. And he says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. And the challenge I want to bring in this session is we will not be able to really remain and prioritize and long for God and his presence to make our home in him if we don't really realize, first of all, how much he loves us. But we have to remain in his love. We have to trust in his love. We have to know his love. And my experience in my Christian life and my experience as I work with people is that there is the biggest distance in the world is the 10 inches between your head and your heart. If I ask you, do you know that God loves you? Do you know that Jesus loves you? You'll say yes. But is it a love and an experience of God's love that is transforming your life, that you are living in, that you are finding your home in, that you are remaining in? Or is it something that actually you've given an intellectual assent to, but is not something that you are living out of? One of the big challenges, I think, for us in the Western church is that we've translated our view of our experience of education into our experience of church. And that is that we get educated in school and we learn a load of things that we never, ever use in our life. So I've learned the periodic table and I've never, ever used it in my life. I've learned loads of calculus in my economics degree. I've never used it in my life. Really interesting things, and I spent a lot of time learning it, but I never did anything. The danger is that we begin to see church in that environment. You're sitting there, I'm speaking, that's the same environment as we have at school and other educational contexts. And you'll listen to me talk about the love of God, but your choice will be, will you enter into it? Will you do something in response to it? Will you actually live in it? So it's not just an intellectual assent that Jesus is looking for. He's looking for an open-heartedness that says, yeah, I want to receive your love, I want to live in it, I want to find my home in your love. That's what you've taught me to do, Jesus. And then to ask, how do I do it? Because it doesn't all get worked out in one go. Again, the process of discipleship is having Jesus speak to us and then trying to step into that, trying to begin to learn that and respond to it in our lives, failing, and then getting up again and say, oh, I've got more to learn. Again, the trouble for us as adults is that we stop learning. We get fixed. We say, this is it. This is my pattern of life and my pattern of Christian faith. Whereas our whole experience as a little child, which Jesus says we're to be childlike, is how do you learn? You learn by having a go, and then you learn a bit more by having another go. So I read a study recently where somebody asked a group of four-year-olds to draw a picture of something and then to bring it to the front. And they came up and they were really excited about everything that they'd drawn, and they showed it to everybody. And then they asked a group of 16-year-olds to do it, and they were embarrassed. And between 4 and 16, the insecurities of, I have to get it right first time, how my performance goes, reflects on who I am, come in. And for us as adults, as Christians, there is a real danger that we will only do something that we feel we will get right. We'll only try something that we feel we know how to control, that we understand fully. And yet actually, Jesus is saying to us, there is a depth of relationship with me that you've yet to know. And so my command to you is remain in my love, remain in me, let me remain in you. Go deeper into that. And to do that, we'll have to begin to do some things that perhaps we haven't done before. Another one of my illustrations on this is when my daughters were young and they were learning to walk, they would, you know, you'd stand them up, they'd be a bit unsteady. My wife would be the other side of the room or a little further away, say, come to me, Alice, come to me. And she'd toddle over and then she'd fall over. And then I'd say to my wife, oh no, we've got a non-walker. She's never going to walk in the whole of her life. We better now have strategies for the rest of her life to cope with the fact she can't walk. No, we didn't say that. We said, get up, have another go. You were made to walk, so we're expecting you to walk. Therefore, let's have another go. You and I were created to know the fullness of the love of God. God created us for himself. You were wired with a spirit and a soul that has the capacity to know more and more of the love of God. And yet, in the brokenness of our world and our experiences, there are things to overcome, there are challenges. And so often what we find is, oh, it's not working. So we have this little thing that if you've ever said to yourself, if you're honest, I've said it to myself, oh, I'm one of those Christians that this doesn't work for me. It works for those people over there. They seem to have got it. They seem to have that experience. But it doesn't work for me. I'm one of those non-able to receive from the love of God, non-able to know the Holy Spirit, non-hearing from God Christians. It's not in the Bible. It comes out of our disappointment and our experience, and it comes partly out of our adult understanding of Christian faith, which is, I get to do what I can do and I can't do stuff I can't yet do. And that's not what we're meant to be. We're meant to be children of God, growing in his love day by day. And one of the phrases that has served me well in my life is, there is more. It's a logical phrase, because God is so much bigger than we will ever know in this life. So in life, this life, there has to be more of him for me to know. And it just requires me to seek him. So what might we do about stepping into the love of God? Another phrase from John 14, my Father will love them and we will come to them and make our home with them. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said to you. God's saying, I want to make my home in you, just as you make your home in me. It's a beautiful invitation to settle down with God, to learn to live together, to learn to share life together. One of the key understandings of the New Testament is that we are made children of God, that we are not left without a father. And Jesus says in John 14, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, you are in me, I am in you. Do you see how Jesus is really wanting to drive home this sense of completeness and being held in God and in his love? And he gives us this picture of not being orphans, but of being his children. I want us just to think for a moment about what it means to be an orphan. An orphan's experience is one of insecurity, of not knowing a sense of protection and provision from a parent that will be there for them consistently. An orphan's experience is not knowing unconditional love from the parents they were born to, living without an experience of that unconditional love. There's a sense of a loss of identity. They don't know who they are. They don't know where they belong. They don't know whose family they are part of. That's the experience of being an orphan. And Jesus says, even though I'm going, I won't leave you like that. God is going to be your Father. He's going to send the Spirit who's going to enable you to know that you're in the Father and me and the Holy Spirit. You belong to us. And to pick up this from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one that he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace, which he lavished on us. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. Ephesians 4. I love the phrase in there where it's his pleasure and will to choose us and to make us his sons. This is all from God. All that he's done is his initiative. We're never ahead of God. It's what the theologians call prevenient grace. Before everything else, God acted. And he did it out of pleasure and will because he loves us. Paul's using a technical term for adoption to sonship from the Roman courts. And that court system had an established practice where a Roman family would adopt often a slave into their family. They are a family probably that doesn't have a son born naturally to them. They have no way of passing on all that they have as an inheritance, no way for their family name to carry on. And so they would adopt quite often a slave boy in order to establish them as their son. And the legal process involved this. First of all the debts were cancelled. So that slave had everything cancelled and so was no longer a slave. Secondly, they received the full rights of a son. So they had every right that a natural born son would have, including the right to inherit in the future. And the third thing, which made it even stronger than natural born children, is those parents gave up their right to ever withdraw and disown this son. They signed a document to say, we will never ever withdraw this adoption certificate. And Paul is saying, that's what God did for you and me in Jesus. Out of his pleasure and his will, before you ever deserved it, while you were still dead in your sins, while you were still slaves to sin, he came and he adopted you. How did he do it? Well, first of all, he did it in Jesus by cancelling your sins, your debts, wiped clean. Secondly, by welcoming you into his family by his Spirit, that you are his children. His sons and daughters, full rights of as any son or daughter would have. And thirdly, that you have an inheritance that will never ever be taken away. That is what God has done for you. Now the really exciting thing for this is that this deals with all the things that orphan-heartedness struggles with. It deals with our identity. Who are we? We are children of God. Whatever else is happening in your life, whatever is good or bad, whatever you feel is a sense of a failure or a shame about that, whatever has gone on, you have been chosen to be a child of God, and that is your identity. Nobody can take that away from you. Secondly, we have the unconditional love of God himself. This is a love that we haven't earned. This is why it's so important, because if you earn it, you can lose it. But if you haven't earned it, you can never lose it, because it was given freely. Thirdly, we have this inheritance. The implication of these chapters, 14 to 16, is that Jesus begins by saying, in my Father's house in heaven, there are many rooms. I'm going ahead of you to prepare a place for you. He's saying there is an internal inheritance for you, but the really good news is you begin to make your home in me today. You're not just waiting for eternity, but you're beginning today. But from now on, you're living in God's house. From now on, you're part of the family. From now on, you're beginning a life that starts now, but lasts for eternity. That's what God has done for us out of his love. But as we live in God, as we experience that, we need to understand that we can not just wait for it, not just have it theoretically and intellectually, but we can have it as an experience of our daily life. We'll come on to that in just a moment. When I was 20 at university, I had a very difficult summer in between my second and my third year because a relationship, a long-term relationship, ended. And I ended it really, really badly. I've learned many things in my life, but to learn not to break up over the telephone with somebody you've been with for a long time was a key lesson. Also when she's very seriously ill. So that's my confession. I know I'm a terrible person, it's all grace. And it was really bad. And I was very, very upset, and I realized I'd really blown it. And our collection of friends let me know how badly I'd blown it. They were really hard on me. And I was coming back to university, really fearful that I was just gonna have no friends, and they were just gonna isolate me and reject me. And I came into Birmingham New Street on the train as I was coming back to university. And I was just praying, I was saying, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to cope with this. I've really blown this. It's my fault, but somehow I need some help. I don't know what's going to happen. Got out of Birmingham New Street, I begin to just walk down the ramp. And as I walk down the ramp, I have this little thought in my mind. You're a son of the living God. It came from God, but I didn't really realize what was going on. And then it happened again. And then I paid attention to it. And then it happened again. And as I walked down this ramp down to New Street, I grew 10 feet in stature within myself. The fears that I had before had gone, and I experienced the Holy Spirit pouring the love of God upon me as his son. Nothing had changed, and yet I was totally different. I got to the point where I almost wanted to say to the people around me, do you know? I'm a son of the living God. Do you know who I am? This is who I am. My circumstances were still really difficult, and they were still very difficult, but I was transformed by the knowledge of God being my Father, his love poured into my heart by the Holy Spirit. What God did on that day is really what he did and Jesus said he will do in the story of the prodigal son. That the son is in the pigsty, he's done all kinds of terrible things as I had. And yet he's just willing in a little way just to open up the door to the Father again and say, I wonder if you could help me. I wonder if there's a way back. And what Jesus says is while he was still a long way off, his Father saw him, was filled with compassion, and he ran to his son. I wonder if you know that God runs to you. This is completely socially unacceptable in that culture. Nobody ever ran. And yet he runs, he picks up his robe and he runs because he doesn't want another second away from his son. Genuinely, as you turn to God in prayer sometimes, by the Spirit he runs to you because he's been longing for that moment of intimacy with you because of how precious you are to him. And then it says that he ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. That a picture of intimacy that quite often makes us feel uncomfortable. We have a structure of our relationship with God, and yet where in that relationship is a sense of the embrace of God? The throwing himself upon us, the kissing us. Because that's what Jesus says the Father does to us. He didn't earn it. The son in the pigsty didn't earn it. He tried to earn it by being a servant. The Father wouldn't let him. It's all by grace. It's just because he loves us. Now, how do we know and how do we sustain this relationship with God of love? I think that it's really important that we understand this is to be an experience, a daily experience. It's not just to be the theory and it's not just to be one-off moments, but it's to be a life that we live, not just a one-off or just moments. So often we compartmentalize our lives and we need to create lives that consistently live in the love of God. So how do we know that God loves us? How do we experience his love? Jesus says, first of all, that he prunes us. If we're fruitful, he says, actually, I have to do some pruning. There has to be some growth over time. This is what I was saying. Discipleship is it's an ongoing journey. It's not a one-off experience of coming to Christ. Pruning, I think, is about stopping activity in order to divert life and health and energy into what really needs to grow. I'm sports mad, but actually my younger self would be so ashamed that my current self loves gardening. And I really do. And every year I'm very brutal with the plants in our garden in order for them to grow and prevent woodiness coming into the plant and actually so they bear fruit. I think in our lives that we don't allow God at times to prune us, to take things out of our lives at times that will force us to really go deeper with him. And I think sometimes that is involved with sinfulness, that we need to allow him to discipline us and prune us. But quite often that's to do with activity. And I don't know what you like, but I think we live in a distracted generation. Every moment of my day, I can be distracted by Facebook or an app on my phone or whatever that might be. I can have the whole of my attention constantly occupied by something. And that prevents me at times from giving my heart and my spirit to God, to coming close to him through the day, living with him. So do we let him prune us? Cut things out of our lives. His words, if Jesus says, if my words remain in you, I just want to say there is no shortcut to knowing God and his love and living with him around reading the Bible. And as I said, I'm a little bit obsessed with this, but the reason is because in my life and in those that I see really growing in God, one of the consistent patterns is they read the Bible. And read it every day. I wonder if you do that. He's provided it for you, he's inspired it, he's protected it, he's translated it for you. And the danger is it stays on our shelves, but it doesn't go in our hearts. So I wonder if you read God's word. If you don't, then my encouragement just out of being here is begin to put a plan in place. When will you read it? How will you read it? I have a morning prayer app on my phone, so I'm a good Anglican. I say morning prayer every morning, and it gives me two passages from the Bible to read every day, from the Old Testament and the New Testament. And every day, I'm reading God's Word, and I have a pattern in the morning of doing that, and it will serve you well. It will be a decision that will provide a foundation in your life that will produce fruit for the rest of your life. But if you never nail it, there will always be a weakness there. So we remain in God's love through the Bible. And how do we know that God loves us? Jesus loves me, this I know, because the Bible tells me so. It has to be a foundation in the Word, because our circumstances go up and down, and our lives go up and down. But the Word of God remains forever. And so if we haven't read how much God loves us, if his word doesn't continually draw us back to him in relationship through the word, then we're very vulnerable for the circumstances of life to take us away from the love of God. So it has to be founded in the word. Then we have obedience, that is about obedience to God's word, living faithfully day by day. I'm not talking just about big emotional experiences. I'm talking about just regular living out our faith in obedience to God's word. And the love that we share with God, he talks about his joy being in us and our joy being complete. He talks about friendship with him, and because we're friends of him, revealing everything to us. Those last ones of love and joy and friendship and God speaking to us personally, they are experiences. And I want to just talk about the role of experience in our relationship with God. As I've just said, our knowledge of God and our trust in him comes from the word, The word reveals Jesus to us. It reveals the record of the cross to us. That's where we see the truth of God's love for us. But if you're in a relationship with somebody, if you're sharing a home with them and with somebody that you love, you will have an experience of that love. And I don't want to put any married couples in trouble here, but if you're married to somebody, they need to have an experience of your love for them. It's not good enough just for me to say to my wife, I made my promises to you 21 years ago. I'm never going to break my promise, and that's the end of it. She needs an experience of me loving her. I don't know if you know love languages, but how people really receive and experience love from one another. And my wife's love language is practical help. So I can do anything, okay? I could buy her flowers, I could say the most romantic things to her, but if I haven't done the washing up, it doesn't count at all. I've learned that over the years from painful experience. So our relationship needs to have words, it needs to have practical help, it needs to have lovemaking, it needs to have time and special times. And in those times, there needs to be an expression of emotion and love and an intimacy. Paul says that the picture of marriage is a picture of God with his church, we're his bride. And I want to say that we need an experience of the love of God, not just a theoretical assent or a trusting in a promise. It needs to be a day-to-day experience. We don't rest upon that experience. It's rested on the word of God and on the cross. But that doesn't deny the importance of living in an experiential relationship with God. Without it, our life and our faith withers on the vine of the promise we made. It grows cold. It struggles. We need the love of God to transform us, to take us on this journey of living more and more in love with him, more and more deeply knowing him, of making our home with him. And so it's important that we know how to receive and allow the love of God to transform us, to give us joy, to give us revelation of what Jesus is saying to us. When Paul is in Ephesians chapter 3 talking about the love of God, he says, and I pray with all God's people that you will have power to grasp how high and wide and deep and long is the love of Christ, and to know that love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. He's saying, I'm praying that you are able to grasp this love. That word grasp is the verb that they use to when you sack a city, when you take over, when you wrestle somebody to the floor. He says, I'm praying you can take hold of this love. For not just to be there, but actually for you to take hold of it and it to transform you with its breadth and its depth and its length and its height. And for you to be filled with it. And for you to know it in the deepest part of your being. As he's praying for the Ephesians, he said, that's the most important thing I can pray for you because it will transform you. When I was just starting off in my ordination training, and I just got married to my wife, Bridget. She is a really lovely woman, but she has been used by God to refine me and transform me. she said to me we've been married for about 6 months, and she said to me, she said, John, do you realize that about every month, Mr. Miserable turns up? I said, what do you mean? She said, well, look at you now. She said, you're just depressed and you're like saying everything's gone wrong and you're hiding under the duvet. And this hasn't just happened once. This happens like every month. I go, oh, yeah, maybe it does. She said, what's going on? And we started to talk. And out of what we talked about, we realized that I was driving myself so hard in ministry that I would get to the end of myself and then a little thing would happen, just tiny. But because I was so emotionally and spiritually spent, I would then just collapse. And I'd say all kinds of things. I was never doing anything. I wasn't going to be a vicar or just get completely lost of perspective. And then after resting for a couple of days, I'd go, okay, I'm all right again. And off I'd go again, running really hard again. She said, I think you need to see somebody. I said, okay. So we went and found somebody to pray this through with. And out of what we prayed through, I discovered that deep within my psyche and my soul, I had a belief that I was a failure because of my experience growing up. And even though to everybody else, I looked like I was doing really well, internally, I was trying to prove myself every day. And we got some understanding of that. And then this person said, let's just bring this to God, let's pray. And as she prayed, she said, I've got this image. And this image is of a little child with their teddy bear. It's one of these teddy bears that it is the most precious little thing to them ever. They've just chosen it. They never want to be apart from it. They never want to be separated from it. When they have any sense of emotional need, they want it. And it's the most precious thing to them in the world. And she said, that's how God is seeing you. And I'm going, well, that's all right. That's nice, but that isn't going to make any difference. And then she said, and the reason God is giving me this picture is because that teddy bear never, ever did anything to earn that child's approval. It was chosen. And as she prayed for me, I just wept like a baby. And God ministered to me his love in the most profound way I'd ever known up until that point. And out of that time, the amazing thing is just from a moment in God's presence and of him applying the truth by his Holy Spirit to my heart, Mr. Miserable has never turned up again. That's the difference that the love of God makes. And so just to give a summary of that before we finish. In our lives, without the life, without the love of God, we will live a cycle of grief in which we start on the achievement part in whatever way we might want to define that. We start with it on the sense of who I want to be, and now I'm going to achieve that on my own, independently. And when we have success in that, in some way, I feel a lot better about myself. I feel more significant. Life is going well, and that's good. And because of my significance, I feel more sustained and strengthened, and then I feel a sense of acceptance of that actually I like myself and I like my life, and that's good. And none of those things are wrong. But the problem is they're all completely dependent upon the success of my achievement, however I might want to define that. That might be in family life, it might be in career, it might be in intellectual ability, it might be in ministry, it might be in all kinds of ways. But as long as I'm achieving, I'm okay. The problem is, as I found in those moments, the moment I don't achieve, I'm no longer okay. This is the difference the love of God makes. It starts with acceptance. You never did anything to earn it. You are completely accepted and chosen by God. He loves you. As a result of that, you can receive his sustaining presence and power. As a result of that, we have the significance of our identity in Christ, that we are sons and daughters of God, the Creator, the King. And out of that, we can achieve. And then achievement and ministry and all the good things that we do in life are never in order to feed our identity or our sense of significance. They're a response to and an empowered by the love of God for us, because he gives us freedom to contribute to this world. But it's only a love of God that will touch, that touches our hearts and heals our hearts and our souls, that sets us free from that. It's not an intellectual assent. We all believe that God's love. I always believed that God loved me. I had to grasp it. I had to take hold of how high and wide it was. I had to apply it to my soul and my spirit and let God minister it to me. And it's out of that that we can go on to talk about fruitfulness, which we will later on. But if we start with fruitfulness, then the Christian life becomes a to-do list. Ministry becomes a sense of trying to be successful, to grow a bigger church, to do a better job, all in order to prove ourselves. All those things are good, but only if they come out of a knowledge of the love of God and us responding to the love of God. So I'd like us just to stop for a moment, and we're going to pray. And we're going to listen to some music while we do this in just a moment. So if you want to put your books down, turn your emails off. Remembering what Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you'll bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. I encourage you just to close your eyes so you're not distracted by others. And just in your heart, to come up with just a little phrase that you might want to repeat. Something like, Father, I thank you for your love. I receive your love. Thank you, Jesus. No long-winded prayers in this moment. Just the simplicity of a child. And then I'm just going to pray for you. We're going to listen to some music, and I'll pray occasionally through this time. You can stay as long as you want to. We've got coffee next, officially in 5 minutes, but you can stay as long as you want to, or as short as you want to. So we pray now, Father, as you love us, love each one of us, however we feel and wherever we are. We thank you for your love for us. And if there are tears, it doesn't matter. That's a sign of God drawing close to us. Father, your word says that your Holy Spirit pours your love into our hearts. And so I pray that you would do that now.